Assalamu alaikum. Usually, whenever violence is brought up, it's always a very physical kind of violence that people discuss these days. Domestic abuse, all that stuff, it's usually the entire discussion is framed in terms of a very masculine violence. So it's always talking about physical aggression. And whenever violence is reined in, it's usually reined in terms of its, you know, what is perpetrated physically. And it's rare that violence is discussed in any other form. So aggression in terms of words, the impact of language, and the power language has to influence and aggress, it's not addressed as often. And it's interesting because physical violence obviously is a very masculine thing. Men control through violence because they're physically more capable of it. And women are more likely to influence rather than control, just given their nature and given their qualities and their abilities. So language is basically their tool of aggression. And I find it really interesting that the Quran addresses both physical violence and the violence of the mouth and the tongue, how people speak, violence of speech basically, violations of speech I should say. And there are very clear parameters around physical aggression and verbal aggression. You know, there's laws and prohibitions and restrictions on both. And I find that really incredible because it gives agency to both men and women for what they tend to use most to express their power. Not to say that both can't use either. Like nowadays, women are just as likely to perpetrate physical violence against their partners as men are, even though they do less harm because obviously their capabilities and so on. It's just an interesting thing that I came across because it made me think of this culture of bad mouthing that's become really normal for women to bad mouth their husbands. I've basically decided to record this as a kind of a warning to women, just to make them aware of what it is that we're doing, because I think most of people my generation grew up in a culture where bad mouthing is a cultural norm. It's not just a norm, it's actually encouraged as a part of your power, as a part of your strength, hence all of the sudden you know, overusage of hashtag Me Too, hashtag whatever, you know, expressing yourself verbally to strip men of their power, like getting them demoted, getting them their jobs ruined, getting them kicked out of positions. That's the norm now, and I'm not saying that it's not healthy when there is obvious cases of abuse involved and somebody is abusing their public power, but when it comes to agency and how women express their power, it's very important now more than ever for women to realize that this is influence through our words is our strength, and it's what we use often, and we may have experienced it in our childhood growing up a lot more than we even realized. So personally, I grew up in a culture where it's very common for women to speak very loosely about basically the things that they don't like about the men in their lives, be it fathers, be it husbands, be it brothers or be it sons, but especially husbands. And it's ironic because, you know, some of these women are now divorced, some of them are still in those marriages. And I want to start off by just stating the fact that in Islam, if you do divorce, the terms are to be very amicable, and you're not in any circumstance allowed to tarnish the reputation of the other person. My husband and I were just talking about it, and he was making a comment on how if a man was to badmouth the woman that he wants to divorce, he would just be looked at as scum, because it just looks so bad for a guy to take the mick, especially of the mother of his children. Yeah, if a woman does it, it's almost expected. And it's true. You know, not only was I surrounded by this kind of behavior, but what it does is it actually creates an entire circle of women that have a similar behavior, where it was not just caregivers but friends of caregivers, extended relatives. It was just the norm to sit and just bitch about things that you don't like about the person that you're still with and who you're accepting as, you know, your spouse. And it says a lot about the person and who's speaking, more than it does about the complaints they have, actually. Because it's one thing to, you know, usually this sort of starts happening to a girl, in my experience, from the stories I've heard from my friends, a very strange looking insect from the park in the morning. You see very odd things. The experiences that I've had myself are very common in my friends who have repeated these stories. And when they repeat it to me, they repeat it in the context of what they're now experiencing in their relationships. And what I almost hear is a sort of PTSD of trauma that they've that they're still living from the words that came out of the women around them when they were growing up. So this is real. The aggression in those words is real, and the effect is real. And the hikmah behind controlling your bad mouthing is so deep, and it's so true, because the impact is so real. It's actually just as damaging as physical violence. And this is something we don't give it enough credit for, which is a shame, because we're stripping women of their power, really, when we say that words don't mean anything. They're very important, and Allah prohibited them and set boundaries on them for a reason. So when you know you're a teenager, you're just coming to terms with your own sexuality as a woman, you know, you're getting to terms with the opposite gender, you're kind of starting to think about who you're going to settle down with, 14, 15, 16, 17, and that is snap the age that the women just draw you into their salon circle, let's say, and just start chatting to you about, oh well, you know, this happened, that happened. And when you're young, when you're that young, especially if it's an immediate caregiver, you take their word as gospel anyway, because your mind is still developing. And that's where I'm going to make parents realize, parents of children, now your kids are young if you're my age, but in future, what basically this is you projecting your story onto your child, and you're trying to control the image of the other parent in the child's mind. Not only is that egregious to the opinion the kid has of their parent, their own parent, the other parent, it's also really damaging about how the child sees you, because you're saying that either this person was basically a good guy who I turned into a bad guy, or he was a bad guy, in which case I made a terrible decision. Either way, you're saying you're very stupid, because you either did something really dumb, or you over time, or you started off with something very dumb, and it's your responsibility not to do you know, such basic dumb things. And that's quite damaging to the self-esteem of a child, because that's basically the last thing a child wants to hear, is that their parent has made such a dumb decision or has done anything stupid. It means that basically the child himself is stupid. And also, there's a reason why this child, you know, you're in a position, okay, can I walk away? Do I tell this person to stop? I don't want to really hear this. Is this a instruction that I have to sit here and hear this? Because they're your elders, and you're basically in prison in some way where you can't escape. You have to sit there and listen. And as an adult, there's a reason why you're imposing this discussion on a child and not a grown adult your age. Either you've basically talked about this so much to everybody around you that it's become your habit to talk about this stuff, or everybody, the stuff you're talking about is so crap that nobody else wants to deal with it apart from this one person that can't get away from you, which is why you're basically unloading your emotional burden on a child rather than a grown adult or a therapist or somebody that can actually help you. Or either way, it's a huge emotional dependency on a parent-child relationship, and a child is not there to give to their parent, they're there to receive. And it's basically a form of abuse. And when I witnessed this happening in front of me with some people that we were close to, I would literally see the daughters of these women listening to the bad mouthing of their fathers by their mothers, who were not abused in any physical way, maybe emotional, but they were not doing anything to change their situation. They were just bitching about it. So they wouldn't get up and leave. They were enjoying a nice house, a very, very comfortable lifestyle. Their kids were going to good schools, private ones. So you know, there's enough there to stay comfortably, but not enough to not complain about. And I think there are many reasons, apart from just the emotional abuse, which is a very general term and it has to be pinned down what it actually is. A lot of it is to do with us women as to begin with, which I'll get into later. But the first point is the damage that it does to the young child at this age, very fragile, just forming their opinion of men. And you're hearing all these horror stories of the things that are happening. And obviously at that age, you're very impressionable. So me, when I hear these stories of these men, I would think of them as literally Pharaoh, like this guy is Pharaoh, basically. He's such an aggressor, he's evil, he wronged you. So I would, if I'd see them, I wouldn't return salam. I'd want to spit at their face or slap them upside the head. That was the aggression inside me from the stories that I would hear about these people. And then I would be told, why did you disrespect them? Why did you not say salam? Or why weren't you nice to them? It's like, well, you just told me he was literally Pharaoh. I would treat him as such if he's really done this stuff. And that's when I later realized that actually they are comfortable enough to stay and to maintain a certain level of propriety around society. But when it comes to a young impressionable mind that can't escape, they sit and kind of take a toilet dump of all of their aggression and their anger and their anxiety and their fears and their insecurities on this young person who they just see as a bunch of ears to just crap into. So this is basically an egregious harm. It's not like it doesn't have an effect, because the women that I've seen growing up who have put up with this sort of behavior from their caregivers or the people around them that they trusted as children, either end up in relationships where they're with very good guys, but you know, PTSD, jumpy, like I just saw a rabbit walking across the park, jumpy like a rabbit, like you're just, you know, you can hear something there, you don't know what it is, but your ears go up and you're just like, is it gonna attack me? Is it gonna attack me? So you're constantly in this state of absolute fear and what's the next move? What's the next move? Trying to protect yourself against a harm that you heard in the past happened to somebody else. And you heard it at such a young age that it's left a deep groove in your mind. So that really is gonna take work for you to lift. And that's a burden you carry, not one that your spouse is bringing into the relationship. And that's the fault of the people that you were around growing up, unfortunately, and that's work that you now have to invest in. Though it would be very good if they could take ownership and call out evil for evil and admit wrong for wrong. And that's scenario one. The other scenario is they end up with complete beta or like zeta males, who they are the ones that end up in a dominant position where they basically are the aggressors in the relationship, where no one can mess with them, no one can harm them, no one can touch them. They're in such a power misbalance that they are the ones that are in a position to perpetrate abuse more than the other person. In both scenarios, it's a case of PTSD playing out, where there is a deep fear of the potential that can go wrong that has been played out to them in many scenarios from many women all around them, you know, just bitching about all the things that happened, which is a one-sided perspective. And I learned that young, thank God, to not trust the words coming out of one person's mouth, one perspective, because then it helped me to also question my own story. Like, is this really what happened? Is this just because I'm upset about something else and I'm projecting it? What's going on really? You know, to look at the bigger picture and so on, take a step back. And yeah, to go into the reasons, like taking a step back, that's the time for you to examine your own insecurities. Like, for example, I would hear many times women accusing their husbands of having affairs or attempted affairs when they had absolutely no witnesses or no proof or evidence of that behavior. And it's very actually harmful for people so close to you that are in a close relationship to hear them accuse somebody that is so close to you of that, because it's like, well, that damages a child's perception of that other person. You're saying that person who's responsible for me is like an adulterer, is like not really a Muslim. It's a very damaging accusation. And I think it comes from women's, now, you know, in a position of marriage myself, you know, if you wear a hijab, for example, or you are in a position where modesty is either imposed on you or you choose it for yourself, you're obviously reducing your physical attraction enormously by putting a scarf on. You're hiding yourself. That's the whole point. And women always want to know that they're the most attractive possible to their spouse. So what the insecurity that comes out of reducing, for example, your market value to everybody else, you end up projecting that jealousy or that insecurity onto other women, and like second guessing your husband or your every other person that comes in their vicinity as a potential threat, whereas it's just your insecurity, and that's something you have to deal with. Like, maybe you were made fun of as a child for your teeth or for an accident or for your face being lopsided or one feature being uneven compared to the other. That's your insecurity that you have to deal with. It's not, again, the burden of your spouse to carry, and it's not fair. So that could be one thing. Another thing, again, is that women have very little physical control just because they are so much physically inept compared to their spouse. They're smaller usually in height, in stature, in size. So just out of a sheer ability to control, they tend to overdo, you know, everything else that they have within their power to gain an illusion of control. Like, they'll shout louder, they're more likely usually to hit children as well, just to put them in line, because they can't physically assert any sort of control other than influence, which takes an art basically to learn, and it takes a totally different approach. So those are some of my thoughts, and I think that it's really worth examining the extent to which women, I've definitely come across a culture and been raised in a culture where we are taught to run our mouth against the men in our lives. And it's not only a norm, it's encouraged. It's actually seen as a strength, a power, as almost as if you're being honest and you're being fair or just or somehow empowered if you run your mouth against the men that support you in your life. And what you're doing as a result is you're bringing down that man who's actually walking next to you, and he's the one you're relying on to support you, to protect you, to protect your home, your children. And if you damage his reputation, what you're doing is damaging his capacity to be able to do all those things. So in the long run, you're just hurting yourself. It's a very self-sabotaging thing to do. And I would really ask the men in our lives to be aware of the fact that this is a hugely damaging culture, which has become so normalized through feminism and many other mass media and so on, and it's not been critiqued enough. And basically to realize how much patience is needed on the men's side to deal with these habits that we've picked up from the adults that we observed in our lives, and how we could have been taught better, but we weren't. So it's up to us. A lot of it is self-correction on our own. And I really invite the women that I know to take on this journey and to be the bigger version of what they couldn't find in their own past, and to be the better version of what they wish they saw in their role models. Because you know how we were taught to behave. You know how the Quran sets out examples of slander. It's, you know, what one tongue received from the other, it's a great sin. There's a whole surah about it. To, you know, just the fact that it's a sin to leave somebody burdened with a slandered reputation after divorce proves that how can you be with this person and still slander their reputation? You know, if divorce itself doesn't allow you to do that, how can living with them, eating from them, living under their roof, or taking their protection, whatever, and taking their help in any form, and still slandering them, you don't have that right. So it's just an important thing for me, first and foremost, and for all my friends and everybody around me, just to remember that.